Good morning, Facebook folks. Yes, sir. Very much so. Well, folks, as we wait for the choir to come in, I just want to remind you that next Sunday, we set our clocks back an hour. You get an extra hour's sleep, but you're welcome to be early and join one of our small groups. But you, next week, which means that the dark evenings are coming, and so be prepared for all that entails. But we're glad to welcome you here this morning. Our Facebook Live folks have already been on for 6 minutes. They are watching you sit there in the pews, and they're watching everything you do. So be prepared. You can't see them, but they can see you. Feel free to wave to them. And as soon as we get the choir in here, we'll get started this morning. Our network audience is delayed, but we'll just show a few commercials. Clothed in majesty, let all the earth rejoice. All the earth rejoice. And darkness cries. Good morning. Dear high, trembles at his voice. Trembles at his voice. How great is our God. Magnify your name, Prince of Peace, mighty God, Lord God Almighty. Where's everyone? God Almighty. Well, thanks, Janice, and good morning. Welcome to worship. Whether you're here with us in person or at home on our Facebook Live feed, we are glad you've chosen to join us this morning. October 31st, the last day of October, that we know in pop culture is Halloween, but in the church calendar, it's also known as All Saints or All Souls Day, when we celebrate those who have gone before us. It's also Reformation Sunday in the history of the Protestant church, where we celebrate the Reformation. There is much for which to be thankful this morning. The sunshine is one of those things as well. So I want you to hear these words from Psalm 139 as we gather together this morning. It says, is there any place I can go to avoid your spirit, to be out of your sight? If I climb to the sky, you're there. If I go underground, you're there. If I flew on morning's wings to the far western horizon, you'd find me in a minute. You're already there waiting. God's already been waiting for you and me this morning. And I think that is such an encouragement in a world where sometimes it feels like we're forgotten or alone. God says, I'm right here waiting for you. And so as we begin this morning, won't you join me in a prayer of invocation? Lord, you woke us up this morning and you started us on our way. And we ask that you might give us eyes to see and ears to hear and hearts to follow you. Thanks that you arrived before we did this morning, that you're waiting for us in this place, but that you're active and moving not only inside these walls, but throughout your creation. And so meet us in this place, we pray, O Lord, that we would be encouraged by our time together, and that in so doing, we would move out into your world and join you at work. We pray in the name of the one who came to join us, even Christ our Lord. Amen. I'm going to invite you to join me in a call to worship, a responsive reading this morning. as we prepare our hearts to come together and worship. God has given us this day for praise. God has given His Son to us that we might learn ways of peace and mercy. Come, let us worship this great God of abundant mercy and love. Let our songs, our words, and our thoughts reflect God's healing and restoring love. Amen. Well, as you're able, won't you stand and join us in this beautiful song of praise that reminds us how great a God we worship. How great is our God? Let's sing together. We're going to do Chris Tomlin's version because it's got a little more oomph to it this morning. Gets a little high, so hang in there. It simply says this: how great is our God. The splendor of a king. Amen. And please be seated. What a beautiful, beautiful reminder that we're not alone. How great is our God. He's such a great God that he says, "Come unto me, all you who are weary and heavy burdened, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you, for my yoke is easy and my burden is light." We gather together to lay our burdens at the foot of the cross, to be mindful that we have a God that says, even in the difficult times, I will carry you. And so we come to our time of prayer this morning, mindful that of the words we just sang, how great is our God. If you watch the news and you listen to the radio or podcast, the world would tell you how great are our troubles. But we just sang, how great is our God. Bigger than all of those things that we carry together. Bigger than the burdens that we look at and have no idea how to address. Bigger than anything we can ask or imagine is our God. And so this morning we come into our time of prayer. We begin with a time of confession, realizing that oftentimes we focused on those big troubles rather than our big God. And so, Shane, if you would put the words of that unison confession up behind me, this unison prayer that reminds us that we don't always get it right and that we need to seek God's amazing grace. Won't you pray this prayer of confession with me? God of justice and righteousness, your call beckons to us to live faithful lives, to turn from wickedness, to walk in your ways. Yet it is so easy to turn aside, to speak a thoughtless word, to ignore those in need, to strike out in anger, to put you in a box marked for Sunday only. Forgive us, implant your word in our hearts, and cleanse us from all evil. By the power of your love, transform us that we might faithfully serve you. Amen. Take some quiet moments, if you would, just to give yourself up to the Lord and to lay down those burdens at God's feet. Your word says, O Lord, be still and know that I am God. We thank you, God, that in our stillness you come, and that you promise that as we confess our mess, that your grace and mercy are big enough to wipe it away. Hear our prayer, we pray. Amen. Well, I know there are many needs within the congregation and community, and I want to make you aware of a few. But before I do that, I want to ask you, where in the world have you seen God working in the past week? Miss Barbara. All right, so Barbara is thankful that she got to watch Leroy turn 50. Makes her feel young and spry and alive that her fourth kid made it to half a century. And that, what a blessing. Where else have you seen God at work this week? Yeah, Miss Jackie. That's right. Yeah, Jackie's house faces due east, and those trees that have been there forever blocking the sun are gone, which probably means new houses, but what a blessing to see the sun rise. Anybody else? Yes, Miss Doris. Yeah, Pastor Poppy went over and did a visit to see her great-grandmother, and what a blessing of intergenerational ministry. So thanks for sharing that and for making that happen. Yes, Ms. Karen. Yeah. Thanks, Karen. Karen has a friend with ALS, and she's needed to do some care. And when that friend fell, she's been physically having to pick him up. And what a blessing to have a friend that can do that. Anybody else? Mr. Ted. Okay. All right. We want to pray for Gary Walters, who's in hospice. Yes, sir. You see God at work. Amen. You know, your brother celebrated a birthday as well, and that's amazing. That's right. So that definitely, he tried to call him and won't answer, which means he's playing and having fun, which is good. Bobby, you got something to add to all that? Outstanding. Mr. Bobby Ward, it's been a long couple years of health battles for you, and we're thankful you're well. We want y'all to be praying for Bill Brown. He and Kathy are in the mountains loving life, but Bill hadn't been feeling well, and the doctors can't figure out why, and so lift him up in your prayers if you would. Ask you to pray for Will Cain's mom and daddy, who've got this awesome COVID virus and already had some lung struggles. So pray for them as they battle that. Want to ask you to pray for the Unruh family, some seminary friends of ours. I've told you their 16-year-old continues to be bedridden after a year and change of COVID, and she is. They're fighting insurance battles and all that stuff to get her some help. You can see all those names on there. Jerry, Joyce, Becky, Hurley, Miss Julia, Mr. Colin Ward, Mike Dew, Lauren, Cheryl, Dave Gunther, with whom I had a great visit. He's as ornery as ever, but can use your prayers. Anna, Riley, Jean, so many others. And you know other names. So let's go to the Lord in prayer and lift these folks up, mindful that God knows more than we do, desires better than we can desire, and uses our prayers not only to meet the needs of those for whom we pray, but to transform us to be the answers. So let's pray. Lord, you've heard these many names, and you've heard the places where we have seen you, and yet we know you've been at work in so many more ways. Open our eyes, God, to sense your presence all around us, in the laughter of children, in the gentle breeze that blows, in the warmth of sunshine, in the fall colors, in the love of family, in the blessing of friends, in the provision of food and clothing in our homes. Oh, for so much we do give you thanks. But Lord, many we love are hurting and struggling and tired and need your hope and help and healing. So use us to be your hands and feet. Transform our lives and theirs, that we might sense and see and know your presence, even in difficult times. And when we know not what to pray, make us mindful of the words that you taught us, that we lift now together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Well, I'm going to invite you to stand and sing again on this weekend in which we celebrate little people dressed up in cute costumes and we talk about stories of ghosts. I want you to sing out to the immortal, invisible God only wise. Let's stand and sing this beautiful ancient hymn. Man, go ahead and sit down. How many of y'all knew that hymn? Only a couple of? Man, it's a good Presbyterian hymn, I think, Jim. Go back and read the words to that if you get a chance. It's a powerful, powerful song. Immortal, invisible God. When we talk about where do we see him, that hymn reminds us. Well, today our scripture reading comes from 1 Kings chapter 8. And it's not necessarily one that you probably read at home often. It's not the warm, fuzzy one, but we go again to the calling of one of the great leaders of God's people in the Old Testament. We've come through and heard the stories of Abraham and Moses. We've heard the story of Samuel and David. And today we come to David's son, Solomon. And Solomon is a wise character, as many of you know, who's many of the Proverbs were attributed to, as well as the Song of Solomon written in his celebration of love. And this is the story of his calling, not by the voice of God and not by a burning bush, and not by a priest in the temple, but by his father who has reared him up and now comes, Solomon comes into leadership. Hear his story and the building of the temple in 1 Kings chapter 8. Beginning in verse 1, it says, "Bringing all this to a climax, King Solomon called in the leaders of Israel, all the heads of the tribes and the family patriarchs, to bring up the chest or the Ark of the Covenant of God from Zion, the city of David. And they came, all Israel, before King Solomon in the month of Ethanim, the seventh month, for the great autumn festival," like us, celebrating. "With all Israel's leaders present, the priests took up the chest of God and carried up the chest and the tent of meeting and all the holy vessels that went with the tent. King Solomon and the entire congregation of Israel were there at the chest worshiping, if you will, or the ark, and sacrificing huge numbers of sheep and cattle, so many that no one could keep track. Then the priest brought the chest of the covenant of God to its place in the inner sanctuary, the Holy of Holies, under the wings of the cherubim, little fat guys. The outspread wings of the cherubim stretched over the chest and its poles, and the poles were so long that their ends could be seen from the entrance to the inner sanctuary, but were not noticeable farther out. They're still there today, or when this was written. There was nothing in the ark, in the chest, but the two stone tablets that Moses had placed in it at Horeb, where God made a covenant with Israel after bringing them up from Egypt. When the priests left the holy place, cloud filled the temple of God, and the priests couldn't carry out their priestly duties because of the cloud. The glory of God filled the temple of God. And then Solomon spoke. God has told us that he lives in the dark where no one can see him. I've built this splendid temple, O God, to mark your invisible presence forever. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Lord is our strength.
Chris is on. One more time.
We stand and lift up. The joy of the Lord is our strength. We bow down and worship him now. How great, how awesome is he. Together we sing. Thank you.
Well, thank you, choir. If you are interested in joining with them, they practice on Wednesday nights, and they are readying themselves already for their Christmas celebration. And if you want to be a part of that, it's not too late. They still are looking for some folks to dance with some bells on in front of them as they sing. So you don't even need to sing to be with the choir. Well, question for you. Have you ever boxed up something special, important, and put it away only years later to find a box and wonder what that box was? And you opened the box, and there inside the box was a treasure that when you put it in, you thought you couldn't live without, but you had lived without now for however many years, and you took it out, and you weren't really sure what to do with it, so you put it back in the box. Anybody? Anybody have a whole bunch of those in their attic or their shed or somewhere? Those boxes of things that when you get ready to move, and they're piled up, and they just stay boxed up. Military families will tell you in every move when professional movers come, their boxes are numbered with stickers that are a certain color. And there are boxes that some of my friends have that have multiple colors of stickers that have moved all over the country and never been opened again. My question for you this morning is, do we put God in a box? Do we put God in a box? David was a man after God's own heart. And like us, he messed up time and again and had to experience the amazing grace and mercy of God. We have his story throughout Scripture, more written about him than anybody in all of Scripture. And yet, David wasn't permitted to build the temple. That came down to Solomon. And when Solomon's time came to build the temple, he went to allies all over the world and gathered the finest materials to build the greatest structure. And in chapter 8, further on down of 1 Kings, it says, a temple to the name of the Lord our God. What was the purpose of the temple? Why did Solomon want to build it? Why was that the climax of his life's work? Listen to the end of the passage we read, chapter 8, verse 13. God told us that he lives in the dark where no one can see him. I've built this splendid temple, O God, to mark your invisible presence forever. I've built this temple to mark your invisible presence forever. Why did they build the temple? To mark out God's presence. And what did they bring into it? A chest, the ark, a box with two things inside. What were they? The tablets of the covenant God had made with God's people. We know them. You've seen Charlton Heston hold them up, right? At Halloween parties, at churches, they're made out of styrofoam. They were stone tablets chiseled into them, the writings of God, God's law for God's people to live with one another and to be in relationship. And this was God's covenant that God would be in relationship with God's people. And so they carried around the tablets as a reminder of the covenant and the relationship. They had the box. And the box first sat in the tent of meeting, the tabernacle, and now there was a temple, a solid, permanent structure where the box was carried. I think it's funny. Did they open the box? No. Like us, this box of treasure was moved as a sign and a symbol. And on top of the box in the temple, it was believed that this was the seat of God. That when God's presence came, and you heard about the cloud filling the temple, very much like the pillar of cloud by day and fire by night that led God's people through the wilderness, God would descend and be present to God's people. But I ask again, do we put God in a box? What was the purpose of the temple? What's the purpose of this place? What's the purpose of a gathering space set aside for worship of God? Because we've already sung this morning, how great is our God. Sing with me, how great is our God. Right? And we know that he dwells beyond this place. So why a temple? Why a sanctuary? What's the word sanctuary mean? A safe place. Why a box with special things in it? I want you to think about that this morning. Because I think what Solomon says here in the middle of chapter 8 is so important. It says, God told us that he lives in the dark where no one can see him. But I've built this splendid temple, O God, to mark your invisible presence forever. I've told many of you as you came in this morning that I'm a little tired today, and I hope I don't fall asleep during the sermon, because Gerard, my 14-year-old, and I went with his Boy Scout troop to Damascus. We were on the road to Damascus yesterday, Damascus, Virginia, where we took a van with a trailer and our bicycles up the mountain and started on the Virginia Creeper Trail and came 14 miles down the mountain, and that was the really fun part. And then we continued on to the end of the trail and back and did a total of 50 miles on our bicycles yesterday. I was so proud of my 14-year-old as we finished the last mile weaving along the trail in fatigue. As the sun started to go down, we started at 10 a.m. by the time we got to the top of the mountain, finished at 5:15. But along the way, we saw the glory of God. It was 48 and raining. We could have seen it a lot better in sunshine and 55. But it was 48 and raining. Dismal and damp and cold. But as we would drive through the forest, at times it was almost as if the lights had been turned on. For the arches of golden leaves that under which we passed were absolutely mesmerizing. God told us that he lives in the dark where no one can see him, and I've built this splendid temple to mark your invisible presence forever. Gerard and I saw the presence of God yesterday in the glory of the autumn leaves. My 14-year-old asked me a question en route as we were looking out over the mountains at this beautiful, picturesque scenery. And he asked me a question, I believe, of theology, not science, but here's what it said. Dad, why would God make the leaves so very pretty right before they all fall off? Why would God make the leaves so very pretty right before they all fall off? I could answer it with chlorophyll and compost and talk about science and biology. But his question was deeper. Dad, they're so pretty. Understood in his question was, it would be nice if we could just enjoy them this way all the time. But my answer to him is the answer that Solomon gives of the temple. God has told us that he lives in the dark where no one can see him. But he's turned these leaves to mark his invisible presence forever. I believe, and I told my son this, that God changes those leaves into the glorious, vibrant colors of autumn precisely for the season that will come after, when the leaves are gone and the trees are barren, that we can remember the glory of God that shone in them in the season before, and live with hope in the winter that the one who brightened the leaves in the autumn will bring back the fresh, bright greens of spring, and that the God who seems invisible is right there with us all the time. What was the purpose of the temple? To mark God's invisible presence forever. Why did they have a box? To remember the words of God that created a relationship and a covenant. It says, come and remember the word of God, the relationship that we have. In a world that doesn't acknowledge him, in a world where it's hard to see him, come to the temple and be mindful that God is. Remember the name of God, Yahweh, I am. And they didn't come to the temple every Sunday. They came for the festivals, handful of times a year, and it was a big deal to get the family out the door and on the donkeys or the camels or on their feet to come to worship. I think that's important for us in 2021 to remember that they didn't come every Sunday. They came when they could, to remember what they would of the God whose name is I Am, the God who is. What happened in the temple, unfortunately, happens, I believe, in the sanctuary. Solomon built the temple to mark God's invisible presence forever, that those who came in would be connected, not so that they could only stay there, but what? So that they could return home and know that the invisible God was with them and present, and that they could point out where God was in their midst every day. And they would come back for the festivals to be reminded of God's presence, so that when it was hard to see, when the trees were barren, they'd be mindful of those autumn leaves that shone and the new spring leaves that were coming. And they would listen and worship and sing and sacrifice and hear the words of the covenant, the relationship that God wanted to have, and then they would go out. But something happened to them as it does to us. And God became only the God that sat on the box. And if they could come and do the right things in the right building in front of the box, then they could do what we do on our offering envelopes. Y'all remember what you used to do? You would check, Bible brought. We call this in the Army, checking the block. Check, Bible read daily. Check, prepared for my Sunday school lesson. Those are all good things. And if we checked all the boxes, we worshiped God in the box, and we then could go off and Monday through Saturday live life knowing that we would visit God again where? In the box on Sunday. And so Solomon builds this glorious temple of splendor to remind people that God cannot be contained, even in the greatness of the temple that was built. Be mindful that God is bigger than all of this. And unfortunately, over generations, they began to try to keep God inside the walls. Why do we want to put God in a box? Why would we want to keep God in a box? If you're carrying a critter that's dangerous, anybody have friends whose kids have snakes or lizards or anything? Y'all just throw them over your shoulder when you carry them around? I've got friends that do that. But most of us that are concerned with the power of these little things, we stick them in a box. Because if they're in a box, we can do what with that critter? Control it. And if it's in a box, we can control it, and we let it out when we want to let it out. And if we don't want to let it out at all, we put it in a box. In fact, we might even let it live in a box that has clear walls all the time, right? Pretending that it has all the freedom in the world, but really it's in a box that we control. God told us that he lives in the dark where no one can see, and I've built this splendid temple to mark your invisible presence forever. So that you can see how big he is and leave from this place and see him alive and well. Okay, sorry. Just making a comment to my mother over there. Forgive me. God in a box. What happens is if we have to be in the box to meet God, we have to keep coming back to the box, right? And so what happened was instead of just coming the five times a year at the temple, the priest came all the time, but we began to say that we meet God in this place inside the box, and I can come here and meet him. And when I go out there, then I'm in the world that belongs to whom? God. And so I ask again why we have a sanctuary and why there's a temple. Because sometimes it feels as if God's invisible on the outside. And we come here to be reminded of the stories and the Word of God. In the beginning was the Word, right? John 1. We're going to hear that as we move toward Advent. In the box was the Word that says, I want to be in relation to you, and I've given you ways to live with one another. But the purpose of the box was to see that God was bigger than the box and living out in the world, and come to the box and be encouraged and be mindful and be in community with one another, and then go and open your eyes and your life to God at work in the fields and in the store and in the school and at your work and in your home. And then when it gets hard to see God again, or when it's time to remember what God has done, come back and celebrate and be reminded so that you could go out and see God again. Solomon builds the temple. Not so that we have a place to go that is holier than every other place. Remember what Jesus did on the cross to the Holy of Holies? Remember what happened to the curtain? It was torn in two. That we would have access to the box always and for everyone. So my question to you is, why do you come to the box? I'm glad you do. I hope you sense God's presence when you're here. As an encouragement to go and sense God's presence when you're out there. I'm going to close with the question that my son asked me. Dad, why does God make the leaves so pretty right before they fall off the tree? As a reminder that even when things are barren, that God is present to you and me beyond the box. May it be so for you in the week ahead. Let's pray. God, thanks for the glory of the temple, which no longer stands, but once stood on that mount where all could see, made of the finest materials, knowing that you were greater even than the splendor of the temple. God, thanks for this sanctuary, this safe place to run and to worship, to hear songs that are familiar and words that remind us of a relationship with you. But God, please help us not to lock you in the box, but instead to come to this place to be encouraged, to have our mind and our heart and our vision widened that we might see you everywhere, for you are at work. Oh, may we join you there, we pray, in the name of Christ. Amen and amen. I don't know about you, maybe you're looking to get out of the box. Maybe you're looking for a box in which to belong. You say, hey, I need a place that I can call mine. We'd love to welcome you here at Mount Pisgah. Maybe you're saying, hey, I've kept God in this little box. I want to let God out wide. If God's speaking and moving in your life today, come and share that with us as we stand, as you're able, and sing this hymn of commitment. This is my Father's world. All of it. May you see him there. Let's stand and sing together. Thank you. Amen. Well, before you leave today, we have a presentation we'd like to make. I'm going to invite the chair of deacons down, if she would come and join me. And I'm going to invite one of our past deacons in just a minute to come and join us here. Many of you remember we presented plaques of appreciation to our deacons and their families. And if you walk through the halls of Mount Pisgah and see when different things were built, you'll notice that on the plaques about those projects are names of those that were instrumental in making those things happen. And on many of those, you will see the name of Lawrence Burke. Lawrence is a longtime deacon and leader in our congregation. Lawrence, I want to call you forward this morning in behalf of your faith family, and in particular, this current board of deacons. We want to present you with a handmade plaque of thanksgiving for all of your service to the congregation. So, Lawrence, thank you, and will you all join me in thanking? Thank you, sir. All right, Lawrence will give a speech following the service, but he's working on right. We are tickled. Saying thanks matters. If you get your newsletter this week, you should, for November. And my challenge is for you to thank somebody different every day in the month of November. Yes, we want to thank God, but the way in which we thank God is to thank those made in God's image. Whether it's the cashier, who may be my son at Food Lion, or whether it's the egg farmer that provides you with eggs, or whether it's somebody in our choir that gives music, or a school teacher that teaches your grandkids, or a coworker, or a neighbor, give thanks in the month ahead. I want to let you know about some upcoming events. Women on Mission have been collecting for World Hunger Month. We're always taking donations there as well for Backpack Buddies in the Christian Center. Please be mindful of that, but also know that we're now in our holiday basket mode. You'll see that in the newsletter and some cards out front. We're ready to collect for some families that may not have the things they need to celebrate a feast as you do. And so we want to be able to do that. So take a look at those things. Look at the children and youth offerings we have. Now there's a fellowship event, Friday night movie night, November 19th. More details to follow on that. Robert? Okay, I'm sorry about that. That was a misprint. 6th to 12th grade there on movie night. You'll see our kids in action on Wednesdays that meet every week, and our folks that are meeting Sunday mornings as well. You'll see lots of birthdays and anniversaries, and that's a great way to say thanks to folks. And then we've got our church meetings coming up the following weeks, deacons meetings and business meeting, as well as men's celebrations. So take a look at the calendar, look at your newsletter, and be mindful. Any announcements I've missed? All right. Well, as you go, receive now this benediction. This is our God, our God's world. As you go, having been reminded of the relationship God desires to have with you, may you see God shining brightly wherever you go. May you join God in the work of love and peace and hope and joy now and forever. Amen. Blessings. I think she told me. I didn't mean to be rude, but yes, thank you. Love you, have fun, enjoy the sunshine. Yes, I forgot. Oh, I don't know. Yes, Thursday night. Probably all day Friday. So. Right. So she can work from home. No, that's good. That's all that.
Okay, I got the text, but not until later. Okay, good deal. Well, thank you. Love you. Okay. I'm pooped. If the Braves win. Did y'all stay up and watch that football game last night? Notre Dame won. But it was close. All right, love you. I will see you the end of the week. Of rocks and trees. I know. It's sad, isn't it? Damn. Been watching on. I know. I understand. And yet, I'm glad for those that have to stay home. Okay, well, we're working on making it the sound better, but it's a challenge. So one day at a time. She's well, busy. She's had two auditions, got two jobs, and super busy, but doing great. So I'm tickled. I will. I hope I get to see her soon. Thanks, Janice. So I'll do that when I see her. Bye. Be good.
Terrible.